suggested that perhaps there is a greater need for reflection within state structures about its core competence, about its core role, and where it has to be a facilitator and where is it a competitor. But another point which I also always make in these fora is, it's lovely to have this discussion today, and some of us are fortunate enough to have lived in another time also, before 1991. Would anybody have imagined that today the state telecom provider is number 5 on the service provider list? Did anybody imagine before 1999 that the, I have had the pleasure of and privilege of working in the Prime Minister's office as a director. And in 1999, I remember a meeting in which Mr. Sunil Bharti Mittal had been asked to come and make a presentation to the Prime Minister's Council on Trade and Industry. And he said, "Sir, my vision is that a phone should be available at every pan shop." And everybody in the room laughed. I remember because I was the Babu making the notes, I was making the minutes. And I remember writing in brackets, laughter, because everybody laughed. A phone at every pan shop. But we've seen that, okay? We've seen the government move out of a number of these enterprise spaces, and I think legitimately give space to more efficient use of resources, more efficient enterprises to run those sectors. So this morning I came by Kingfisher from Delhi to Mumbai, and I was earlier booked on Air India, which for obvious reasons did not fly me here. But 10 years ago, I would just not have come to this session. I would just have stayed back and rung up Vineet and said, "I'm sorry, I can't make it because there is no flight to Mumbai." So we can multiply these examples. And I think the assertiveness of the social, I say it in a very positive sense, the demanding of more space, the demanding of better responses from the government is a wonderful thing. Let me tell you, government works best when it is challenged by its citizens. It's only when it feels that it has to respond to its citizen that it improves its performance. Did you hear of RTI 10 years ago? RTI came because there was a pressure for greater transparency of the government's working. The Lokpal bill is being discussed because there is a pressure from the citizenry for a cleaner government. I think all of these could be quoted as examples of how society is impacting better governance. And of course, we have huge room for improvement, much beyond the time that I'm going to serve, or there are many young people here who will actually see much, much better performance from the government, and I hope this very forum will record that another 5 years down the road. Thank you.
Non-profit in the US where profit making has failed, that's why they come in. Number two, there's nothing wrong with profits, that's where charity comes from. And nothing wrong with excess profits, that creates competition. Okay, given this, I have, let's take one example, HIV-AIDS medicines. There were like 10, 15,000. Then the activists came, the people with passion, brought it down. Then the NGOs came, and finally the corporate came. But now I think India manufactures them for $200 a year. Okay. Now here's the question. If I want to take something to scale, I have to bring the government to the table. How do I do that? How do I induce the government to come? And how do I induce the government to take responsibility?
I'm talking about public goods and private goods. If you're talking about public goods, where I would say basic education, basic health, these are, I would define, in the nature of public goods. There, I think definitely the funding cannot, I mean, you cannot achieve your objective unless there is government funding. But the delivery has to be private, because that's where it's efficient. So supposing we leave that space out for a minute, and we come to the next space, which is something like this telecom, airlines, transport. I think here the scope for private enterprise is huge. Where are we really talking about where there is a need for social enterprise? The kind of Jharkhand, Chhattisgarh, the tribal areas, where there are people who are willing to go and work and are shown that their work is successful. I would say that these have to be encouraged by the government. in every way. Firstly, in a way that doesn't, you know, sort of detract from the work and does not actually put a stop to your work, because that itself is a sort of a way, because there are cases where people have been stopped from doing what they're doing. But there's also the positive side of actually supporting such organizations and such social enterprisepreneurs in their work. And I think that's where we are really talking about today. So we are not talking about the Bharti or the, you know, Air India or the, that kind of a thing, because that space I think is more and more for the private sector. After all, hotel industry, why on earth would we want an Ashok group, you know, running a hotel? We don't. We think that completely can be private sector. And as far as the basic social goods are concerned, I think that has to, if it has to be universally accessible, has to be state funded. We're really talking about the in-betweens. So I think that's where the role comes in of the non-governmental role. And I share your views on, to a certain extent, on this for-profit and not-for-profit. In fact, this itself has shaped my own thinking over the last 5, 6, 7 years. This is exactly the thing. You know, you allow that profit motive to be really used for scaling up. And that is a very good example of microfinance. You use the profit motive is what was enabling this sector to scale up. But somewhere there was a greed which came in at some stage. We cannot deny that. I mean, after all, greed has brought the world down. So there is the market failure does happen. So I will not say that competition can achieve everything. In the financial services industry, competition, it is found, does not deliver. There are externalities. So there is a market failure, and one has to correct for the market failure. So that doesn't necessarily mean by putting a cap on return on assets, but I said the situation that got created was so piquant because of the manner in which the scaling up was happening.
Hi, I'm Shilpi. How do you get the government to really actually acknowledge the social enterprise? Because whenever you go for any scheme, any grant, any approach, even funding for a research or development project, it's always that you have to be a non-profit. So where does the social enterprise fall within this? We've all been discussing social enterprise, but a social enterprise is actually not recognized in any format, because the moment we put in something which says it's government, it's a, you know, a private company, then we're not accepted, right? And we have to find another partner to work with. So how do we change this?
Shilpi, I'll take this. We don't have an answer for it. The challenges are going to be worse with 2012. Maybe, Ms. Thorat.
I think you've raised a very important point, and this is where I feel forums like this should have an active, constructive suggestions for the tax structure, for the form. Now, for example, a limited liability partnership or some other form of organizations. I don't know how many of you are aware that when the chapter on producer companies was introduced in the Companies Act, it was a form of cooperatives which really was owned by the producers. But it did not suffer from the infirmities that the cooperative form of organization did. You had the discipline and the character of the corporate structure, but at the same time, it was a cooperative. So I feel that there are different ways in which social enterprises have to form themselves, even the very form of organization, because the tax laws, I think, are very critical in this context. One might worry that because there are differential tax laws for different kinds of companies, there is arbitrage and people misuse. Now, this is always the trouble of regulation. Because there is misuse, you bring in a law which is to curb the misuse. But in the process of doing that, you have actually removed the facilitating aspect of the law. And how do you really balance between that reaching your objective and preventing that misuse? I think here is some place where you can really apply yourself and come out with something very constructive.
We'll have last two questions.
If I can.
I think there are two ladies, so I'll leave it to the two ladies.
Okay.
Go ahead and can you pass on the mic after that to Rohini?
Dr. Muhammad Yunus, and he defines social business in a way that you may like actually, because he defines it as a business solution to a social problem, but where the investor of the business is selfless. And he says that the way to ensure that the investor is selfless is to insist that he has zero return from the business. So he puts in a certain amount of principal and he only takes that principal out, and any further profit remains in the company to help it to grow. So how do you see this as a model for private-public partnership where the funding is coming from the
government? Thanks. Yeah, I read that book, but actually I don't totally agree with the definition, because I think there has to be some return on capital. But do you cap that return? In fact, when the Malegaon committee came out with the recommendations, it was like, okay, we don't mind you making money, but you're capping the returns that you get out of it. Because those who invest in it should have some objective other than, they should get a reasonable return, but there has to be some other objective to it, a social objective. So that's when you're having this space of social enterprise. Because there has to be an objective other than the purely for-profit objective. Whereas profit is a very good motive because it really makes you efficient, it really enables you to scale up. But it's still troubling me. I don't think I'm very convinced that the answer is there. But there is, somewhere there is this thing. I'm also part of the Indian Cancer Society, and we set up this fund some time back, which is actually you put in those who want to, say, give for cancer prevention and things. You can get your return. You can opt not to take your return. Or you can opt to take 50% of your return. So this fund has attracted investors. There is a little bit of return aspect to it, but there is a aspect of taking back your principal, getting some return, but giving up of return. So that's I don't know how it's going to work, whether it really works well or not, but there is something to say. I don't think we can, like Yunus has written in his book, completely say you just keep everything in the business, don't take anything out. I'm not sure how many investors you'll get.
Just one line to add to that. In a 12%, 13% inflationary condition, that's actually minus 12% every year as well on the principal itself. So, Rohini.
Especially based on natural resources like water. And then you say social entrepreneurs can step in for profit. What a shock. This is to me the area of Samaj and Sarkar, not so much of Bazaar. Drinking water, which is a fundamental right of the people. Now, are we going to allow the market, especially the market reforms that we have seen prevail in the world today, and the kind of, we are saying that this is now a new asset class, and hot money is going to chase it. We have recently burnt with microfinance. What assurance do we have, Pankaji, you are talking about, what assurance do citizens have that if social entrepreneurs step into this place, exactly the same thing will not happen again, and we will have to pay 100 rupees per litre for our basic 20 litres of drinking water, without which people cannot live in a poor country. Where are we heading? There are some places where the market must not go. What are the opinions of the panel on this
side? Well, I was like Shavag when he